What do you see in these pictures? Objects? Faces? Or do they just look like random arrangements of lines and blobs? If you don't see anything specific, it's probably because you're not a computer. These pictures were specially designed to be recognized by machine vision algorithms. You see blobs, they see a shark, binoculars, explicit nudity. But the algorithms that see these things are the same ones being used in more and more parts of everyday life. They steer self-driving cars, they monitor content on the internet, and they even unlock your phone. And the fact that they don't see the world the same way you do, it could be a problem. The science of teaching computers to see goes back to the 1960s, and it coincides with the creation of the field of artificial intelligence. Early computer vision systems were very basic. They could process only the simplest versions of 3D scenes, rendering the world in crude shapes and planes. But in recent years, a revolution in AI, particularly deep learning, has created sophisticated vision systems which can outperform humans at a number of tasks. To date, we've used deep learning to create vision algorithms that can identify cancerous tumors better than a doctor, or tell the difference between 100 different dog breeds in a millisecond. Or they can just tell you whether the food on your plate is a hot dog or not. Okay, most humans can do that too. But for all these achievements, AI doesn't look at the world the same way humans do. And that's what these bizarre prints are meant to demonstrate. They're the work of Tom White, an academic and an artist from New Zealand. He made them by essentially reverse engineering a number of vision systems like those used by Google and Amazon.
So I started looking at these classifier networks, which knew how to classify or how to understand an image, and I was wondering if I can invert that process.
The prints are generated using a production line of algorithmic programs. First, a drawing system generates some abstract lines, and the image is fed into a machine vision classifier, which then tries to guess what object it might be. Based on the classifier's guesses, the drawing system then tweaks the image and feeds it through again.
I mostly take a hands-off approach because I really want to know how the algorithms see the world. And so after I've set the systems up, I kind of sit back and let it run for a long time and see what comes out.
But if that's an algorithm's view, what does it look like to humans? We asked Verge staff to guess which object each print represented. In essence, we asked people, can you think like a computer?
Okay, you want me to say what I think that is?
I'm just imagining, like, it's, like, underwater and they're, like, a bunch of, like, fish or bugs.
This one just looks like Hot Topic.
A car?
It's a starfish.
It's a starfish. Great.
Train on train tracks? Subway?
This is someone getting pushed in front of a train.
It definitely looks like somebody's, like, conducting with, like, the wave motions.
Like something on a stove?
Spider. Oh, for real?
Okay.
This is a dancing elephant.
Like the wheel of a boat.
An elephant.
This one's a whale. Is that a whale? Do people do good on this? Like, am I the... Okay.
Tom's work plays with the limits of AI, but in an abstract way. So here's a more concrete example. Let's say you're a computer scientist and you're training a machine learning program to recognize animals at the zoo. You would collect a bunch of pictures of zebras, lions, giraffes, etc., and you'd feed them into this algorithm, which would then look for patterns in this data. So after studying the pictures, it might conclude that if it sees something with a long neck, boom, giraffe. If it sees stripes, that's a zebra, and so on. There are problems with this approach, though. First, the algorithm doesn't know anything about the world beyond that data. So, if you get a new addition to the zoo, like a penguin, it's not going to know what that is. The second problem is that the way it makes decisions might not be very sensible. If it decides that all animals with stripes are zebras, for example, what happens when it sees a tiger? This is why researchers often describe AI as narrow or brittle. These systems only work in very limited scenarios, and when they come across unexpected data, they often break down. This becomes really clear when you look back at Tom's art. For example, look at this red print here. The object it's supposed to represent is a cello. You can see the curves of the body of the instrument and the vertical lines for the strings. But there's also this other shape hovering behind it in light red. That's the person playing the cello. Now, the reason this figure appears is because the pictures that were used to train the algorithm included the cellos and the cellists too. But because the program has no understanding of what an instrument or a musician is, it just blurs the two together. Or there's Tom's tricycle.
when I see a tricycle, the first thing I think about are the wheels, and maybe in the back of my head I count them.
But vision algorithms are terrible at counting, so the number of wheels is no help. They lock onto the shape of the frame, a triangle, and think that that represents the essence of a tricycle at its best.
To me, this shape that it comes up with doesn't remind me of a tricycle. It looks like a bunch of lines, but I guess I gain an appreciation for the different ways of viewing things. It's almost like visiting another culture that has different ways of interpreting or relating to objects.
To drive home the differences between human and machine vision, we decided to turn the tables on the algorithms. So we took the same objects in Tom's art and abstracted them using a human algorithm. We made the algorithm play Pictionary against us.
So I'm drawing a spider, which weirdly kind of intimidates me. See what the computer thinks. Well, they said it was an invertebrate, but I actually can't remember now if spiders are invertebrates or not.
The cello says, pigs, black and white, drawing, wing, joint. The cello is a little more complex, so like, I didn't get that at all, like anywhere near that.
But why does this matter? Well, because despite the limitations of machine vision, we're trusting it with more and more aspects of our lives. Take self-driving cars, for example. In the future, the idea is that they'll rely totally on what computers can and cannot see. No humans needed. So teaching a machine to spot the difference between a pedestrian and a stop sign will literally be a life or death matter. The first fatal crash involving Tesla's self-driving software, for example, was partly caused by algorithms which couldn't distinguish between the side of a white tractor trailer and the bright sky behind it. And when you think about the other places we're starting to use these algorithms, in CCTV cameras, in military drones, it becomes worrying. Now, this doesn't mean we're building completely broken systems. Machine learning engineers are aware of these shortcomings, and most algorithms, like the ones we've described, still have humans in the loop somewhere, making decisions. And Tom, he takes solace in the fact that the algorithms aren't any smarter than this. He suggests that we should be thankful that a computer still struggles to count the numbers of wheels on a tricycle.
I think it's kind of refreshing to see, even when they have very simple models of the world, in a way that's comforting, it's good to know how these things work. It sometimes can give us insight into different ways that we can see the world.
And this one, birds. Like, it's a bird. It's a bird maybe being crushed in someone's fist. And it's like a bird.
It's a butterfly.
It's a butterfly. Yeah, okay. I see
a bird being crushed in someone's fist.